I think I was going for lectures. And then Swinger, a friend of mine, Selo Mameuga, said, "Hey, Alaski, Charlie, them blast America. Where you there?" I said, "What are you talking about?" Yeah, that was crazy. 19 years ago. Actually, it's not about 9/11. It's about the fact that 19 years have gone so quickly.
And
you know,
changed.
19 years has gone so quickly, and I can't imagine what will happen 19 years from today. What are we doing today that will be obsolete in 19 years? Because look at even the way people are making payments. All the announcements I do on the show today is like star something something.
Yeah.
Like 19 years ago, I didn't even have a proper mobile phone. You get me? So to think that now you're paying everything by mobile money, e-commerce has come to stay. What are we doing today that will be obsolete in 20 years? Think about it. Think of two things that you think we would no longer be using. Two gadgets or two devices that will change. You know, it's interesting. So, and the 19 years didn't come at once. It came one day at a time. So nobody's going to get 19 years at once to do anything. You only get one day at a time. So you need to pace yourself one day at a time. That's the thing. So it's a sobering thought to think that we're still here. I'm not sure the world has gotten better, though.
I'm not sure the world has gotten better.
I think it's in some areas we've done better. In some areas, much, much worse. Anyway, my name is Bernard Avele. I'm here with Kukui.
Good morning, Bernardino.
She's in an Arsenal jersey. Looks good. Is it the new one?
Yeah.
Fantastic.
Yeah, it's the new one. Looks
it's
yeah.
a new season.
I love it.
Yeah.
I love it.
We gotta love it. We gotta love it.
Godfrey is also here. Good morning.
Good Godfrey. Morning. I'm awaiting my TomTom shirt.
We'll see how that goes. All right. So there's a lot on the show today. I'm bringing some interviews back on the Business Edition. We're talking to people. Some lady called me from Central Region, and I'm going to talk to her today. She's the head of something health in the region, and she listened to our conversation yesterday, and she says she wants to tell us more about teenage pregnancy in the Central Region. So I'm going to talk to her on the show today.
Okay. Oh,
yes. Great. So that's coming up because I feel we can't just do a touch and go with this one. Yeah, we have to deal with it.
We have to dice it some more.
All right, so let's start with the headlines.
Okay, front page of the Daily Graphic, Bernard. Battle of manifestos. Two ways to manage economy. Photos of President Ananda Danko Akufo-Addo and Mr. John Dramani Mahama, the former president. Lead fight against outmoded customs. President charges traditional rulers.
The Ghanaian Times will uphold country's peace and stability before, during, and after election 2020, President assures. And Trade Minister justifies inclusion of 68 old companies in one district, one factory. 74,000 DKM customers are fully paid, and 109 persons arrested at Medina for attacking bailiff.
Front page of the Daily Statesman. Ghanaian youth can't trust NDC. Nana B urges four more for Nana. December polls will be peaceful. President Akufo-Addo assures Ghanaians works on over $1 billion Pualugu Dam nears completion. Bernard, did you see the photos?
Wow.
Don't go independent. KJM4 pleads with NPP members.
The Inquisitor. Selective amnesia, chaos in GRA over protected Mate Kojo. And commentary, after useless state-sponsored Achim Sakawa demo, what next?
Wow.
Also, 3 in 10 police officers have suicidal thoughts. This is coming from the Psychological Association. Yeah.
Front page of the Daily Guide newspaper. Forgive me, Kennedy begs judge over stupid jab. Poultry farmers issue worries. Don't go independent, you still hear Kate Jemfor. NPP more people-centered than NDC.
The new weekend crusading guide, Protect Life of Judge Threatened by Kennedy Ajepong, CJ urged, and Veep tours flooded communities in Upper East Region. Produce evidence to save your reputation, financial analyst challenges Ras Mubarak, and over 2 million jobs created under Akufo-Addo, says Nana B.
Front page of the Herald newspaper, Kennedy Ajepong puts Akufo-Addo Parliament, NPP, and judiciary in tight corner. Judge says his lawless conduct is worse than Muntie 3. Kwabena Ajepong back in MPP, but Afoku crab missing.
The Ghanaian Observer. Ghanaians will vote in freedom, peace and security on 7th December, President Akufo-Addo assures. You can copy our ideas, but can't copy our performance, Bawumia tells NDC. Bono region beneficiaries of 817 projects and 3 new district hospitals, says the president. Exim Bank sets records straight on alleged payment of 2 million cedis to brand ambassadors and $1 billion Pualugu Dam project to stop flooding from Bagri Dam spillage.
Front page of the BNFT, finally from me, Bernard. SMEs want lending rates further down despite marginal decline. We can only confirm cheating after marking, says Wayek. Permit, license, delays hamper economy's formalization. And comes with a photo of Clara Kasati.
The Chronicle: kidnapped Korean sailors traced to Niger Delta. All right. Mm. Ghanaians will vote in freedom, says the president. Akufo-Addo has already created 2 million jobs, says Nana B. And another Achimcom group condemns demo against Mahama. Can we take the finder quickly? Bono gets 817 projects. NDC manifesto full of populist and discredited promises, says the NPP. Dr. Baumia leads delegation to flood affected areas in Upper East. Finance Ministry engages Social Partnership Council. And First Lady donates medical equipment to whole municipal hospital.
CityNewsroom.com. Give CPP a chance. Electing NDC MPP a waste of votes. This is Ivor Greenstreet. Also, we haven't paid Shatta Wale or other brand ambassadors 2 million, according to the Exim Bank. Now, there's an argument over jobs. We've created over 2 million jobs in our first term, according to MPP. NDC says it's a blatant lie. We are none the wiser. Other stories. Graphic Communication Group urges Parliament to settle debt. And published list of beneficiaries of paid legacy arrears, aggrieved teachers to government. Citybusinessnews.com. Inflation drops to 10.5%, lowest since April 2020. Also, shop owners at Accra Mall demand reduction in high rent charges, and sellers of artifacts are hopeful of increase in sales after airport reopens. If you go to My Joy Online, nobody has insulted Achim Ethnic Group or Fosuan Pofu. Also, Kennedy Japan apologizes to Chief Justice, Judges and Magistrates Association for outburst. Meanwhile, MPP's legal education reforms program, unlike NDC's misleading retrogressive, National Association of Law Students. And of course, debt by Parliament, other state agencies, crippling Graphic Communications Group. Now, if you go to Star FM, apply contempt of court rule fairly, Prof Nana, to judges. Also, Mahama will pay men's gold customers who deserve to be paid. Hey, Opariado. There are two fact checker stories here. Alabi's claim that MPP promised one child, one chocolate is mostly false. And Mohammed's claim that NDC managed 2016 budget without BOG borrowing is false. Both stories on starnews.com. Let's get into the details, people.
Okay, Bernard, let's do politics then.
Of course.
Manifesto, manifesto, manifesto. Front page of the Daily Graphic, battle of manifestos, two ways to manage economy. The two main political parties, the ruling New Patriotic Party and the opposition National Democratic Congress, have promised in their manifestos accelerated economic growth and development if elected into power on December 7. Both parties have offered similar fundamental objectives for macroeconomic management, although the strategies to achieve them differ somewhat. Now, two economists have been looking at the manifestos, Bernard. Mm-hmm. Professor Peter Kwarty and Dr. Said Boache.
Mm-hmm.
And they said the lack of a long-term development plan to which political parties could align their policies had ensured that the parties turned campaign promises into development policies, which they forcefully implemented when they won power, irrespective of the danger such policies posed to the economy and country at large.
Mm.
Professor Peter Kwarty and Dr. Said Boache said that the country needed to change from that practice or risk collapsing the system in the long run. Now, if you go into the context of the story, according to the paper, on two occasions, the National Development Planning Commission, which is legally mandated to plan the country's long-term development, had developed long-term plans spanning 40 years and 7 years. However, those plans have been shelved by the counterparties, mainly on the basis of ideological disagreements.
All right. The president has been in the Bono region, and there's a nice image of him interacting with some queen mothers in the Ghanaian Times. Will uphold country's peace and stability before, during, and after election 2020. Mm-hmm. President Nana Addo-Dankwa Akufo-Addo has stated that the government was determined to uphold the peace and stability of the country before, during, and after the 2020 elections. Okay. He said Ghana's reputation as a beacon of hope amongst nations in the sub-region cannot be compromised on the altar of the upcoming general election, calling for a full collaboration from the chiefs and people of the Bono region to achieve that feat. He offers Ghanaians the opportunity to assess the track record of this government and that of the opposition candidates to choose from, stressing that his appeal to the electorate to give him another four-year term was to fast-track the development trajectory of the country. Mm. He said all of this during the inauguration of the Bono Regional House of Chiefs in Sunyani yesterday as part of his two-day working visit to the region.
Meanwhile, give CPB a chance. Electing MPP or NDC, waste of vote. Ivor Greenstreet, flag bearer of the Convention People's Party, Ivor Komna Greenstreet, has advised Ghanaians against selecting either of the two main political parties, the governing MPP and the opposition NDC, during the coming election. He describes the many voters who believe smaller parties such as CPP do not deserve a vote in the poll as persons who are living under, quote, a grave illusion. He believes only the CPP holds the key to unlocking Ghana's socioeconomic development. Mm-hmm. He was speaking on Point Blank on Eyewitness News yesterday and urged Ghanaians who wish to see change in their lives and the country's governance to try and give the party the nod by showing Ghana's duopoly what he describes as an electric shock.
Well, if you go to the Statesman on page 2, Nana B is speaking. He's a national youth organizer of the NPP.
Mm.
And he says the Ghanaian youth can't trust the NDC. According to him, after engaging with scores of young Ghanaians across the country, their verdict is that the NDC's 2020 manifesto is simply a document full of unrealistic, populist and discredited promises disguised as the People's Manifesto.
Well, the opposition NDC's deputy organizer is reacting to Nana B's claim about 2 million jobs. Also on citynewsroom.com, he says the claim by the NPP that they've created over 2 million jobs in the first term is a blatant lie. And he starts by talking about the claim of 700,000 jobs in public sector, and that this sector has close to 700,000 employees on public payroll, and the country spends $14.4 billion on these people annually. So how is it possible to have created another 700,000 in that sector? So that argument keeps going on. Mm. Let's come back to you in the Chronicle.
The Chronicle is there, but there's another story in the Times about the One District, One Factory, old companies being included in the list. So the trade minister justifies inclusion of 68 old companies in One District, One Factory.
Okay.
68 existing private companies in the country have so far been registered and supported under government's One District, One Factory program. Justifying the inclusion of those companies in the program, Minister of Trade and Industry, Alan Cherimantin, explained that it was to reposition old companies through recapitalization and retooling to boost industrialization and create jobs. One District, One Factory is for both old and new companies.
Mm-hmm.
The idea behind the program is to create competitive companies in all districts. So, if an old company which has the experience and has the potential for growth is there, why do we ignore that one and start another afresh? He was speaking when he toured the factory of Yedent Agro Group Limited, a maize processing company.
Well, let me tell you about the Upper East region and the flats there and the link to the Pualugu Dam.
Mm-hmm.
So I'll give you stories from two papers for this. Daily Graphics back page says VEEP consoles flood victims in the Upper East.
Mm-hmm.
The Vice President, Dr. Mahmoud Baomi, has taught communities along the Bolgatanga Boku Road and the Upper East region to empathize with the people following the extensive damage to lives and properties caused by flood. Portions of the road were washed away, leaving the route truncated, while a major bridge along the route was submerged as floodwaters from rains and the spillage of the Bagre Dam in Burkina Faso poured in torrents from upstream. The Vice President was accompanied by Mr. Ambrose Derry, a Deputy Minister of Highways, Mr. Anthony Carbo, and the Upper East Regional Minister, Ms. Tango Babayake. And on the same trip, Bernard, another story that has emerged.
The President is in VA and the Vice is in the North.
Yeah.
Okay.
So on that same story, he's saying that there has to be a permanent solution to it. Hence, the Akufo-Addo government's decision to invest massively in the Pualugu Dam. And according to him, we have basically understood that to deal with this problem, fundamentally, we have to have a flood control in the context of the Pualugu Dam. That is the most important antidote to all of this. That is why we have moved to secure the project, and this project is the biggest we have in the northern region. And according to him, once the flood waters recede, they will continue work on the project.
All right, now,
says it's near
so this is Pualugu still in Upper East region,
yes,
right? I wanted you to touch on Kennedy Japon. There's a couple of front pages on him, which is interesting because the running mate of the NDC is commenting about judges applying contempt of court fairly. And I'm guessing it's in relation to this. So let me read that story first. Apply contempt of court rule fairly, Nana Jane, to judges. The running mate of the NDC, Professor Jenan Opokwajeman, has called on the judiciary to be fair in the application of the contempt of court rule. The call comes in the wake of the summoning of Asin Central MP Kennedy Jepong by a high court judge after the lawmaker insulted him on television over a land case. Speaking at a meeting with some civil society organizations in Accra, the former education minister said if the judiciary is not seen to be fair in the application of the law, cynicism will grow among Ghanaians. Now, the story she was relating to is the Daily Guide's front page.
Mm-hmm, yep. Forgive me, Kennedy begs judge over stupid jab.
Mm-hmm.
The new Patriotic Party member of parliament for Asin Central, Kennedy Ohene Ajipong, has rendered an unqualified apology to the Chief Justice and the Magistrates Association of Ghana,
mm-hmm,
who have been offended for comments he allegedly made in response to a court decision against him. In an apology letter, the MP explained that he had been sued as a defendant in the case titled Emmanuel Mumpi and and Honorable Kennedy Oheni-Jeripong, and an order had been made without his knowledge. Subsequent to the suit, an order was made against me without my knowledge, which made me furious and angry, thus causing me to express my dismay and anger toward the court on a television program called The Seat on Net2 TV. He stated in the letter that upon sober reflection, he had come to the realization that his expression about the court's opinion was harsh and apologized unreservedly to the judge and the entire judiciary.
The Herald also has that story, and it says that his comments are worse than that of the Muntie 3. So expect this to dominate the news this week, at least for the weekend, before we get to the bottom of it. Now, I wanted to touch on something also quickly. The NDC chairman says nobody has insulted at the Achim ethnic group. This is on my journal line. Chairman of the NDC, Samuel Swampofu, says no member of the party has insulted the Achim ethnic group. He argued that recent ethnocentric comments are calculated to divert attention from the NDC manifesto, which he believes will turn around the fortunes of the country. Now, his comments come on the back of calls from some chiefs and residents of Ochiman who have Achim lineage for the NDC flagbearer John Mahama to denounce comments which they say is derogatory to them. A group calling itself Concerned Citizens of Ochiman on Wednesday demonstrated against the former president and the NDC for allegedly describing them as Achim Sakawa Mafia. Now, this follows claims by President Akufo-Addo that his predecessor, Mr. Mahama, had endorsed a post by MP for Bongatanga Central, Isaac Adongo, describing people in the government as Achim Sakawa Mafias who are looting the state. Now, the group made up of chiefs and residents of Achim Ebuakwa, Kotoku, and Bosome, all in the eastern region, are demanding an apology from the flag bearer of the NDC. Now, speaking at the opening ceremony for a training program for lawyers and other NDC members on electoral laws ahead of the election, Mr. Swampofu said the agitations are being fueled by the governing MPP for political capital. All right, guys, let's go to other stories.
Okay. Let's do some social stories then. What is the aged bill? Help Age Queries.
Okay.
An affiliate of international organization that seeks the welfare of elderly people, Help Age Ghana, has expressed concern over the slow and long process which has delayed the passage of the aged bill, a development that has worsened the vulnerability of the aged in the country. It said for the past 10 years, efforts have been made to get the bill passed, but after all those years, the bill remained a discussion and draft, and wondered if the sector ministry was interested in getting the law passed to protect the aged. Well, we've seen it in some of the manifestos, so hopefully we can get a move on. And the president on the same page is saying, lead fight against outmoded customs. President charges traditional rulers. The president, Anadolu Akufo-Addo, has inaugurated the Bono East Regional House of Chiefs with a call on traditional rulers to be at the forefront in the fight to scrap outmoded rules and cultural practices which have no place in the 21st century.
All right. And in the Ghanaian Observer, your Ghana card will be your tax ID number for easy business transactions.
Nice.
The parliamentary candidate for the New Patriotic Party in the Mpraiso constituency, Davis Ansah Opoku, has urged market women to brace themselves for more support from the government as it plans to use the Ghana card number as a tax identification number. He made this revelation during the sod-cutting ceremony for the construction of a modern market for the people of Asakaka in the Kwehu South District of Ghana. He said, I receive reports each day about the difficulties in getting your TIN, but I have good news for you. From 2021 and beyond, as part of government's digitization efforts, your Ghana card number will double as your tax identification number. This will mean that you can easily open a bank account, access Maslok loans, and even the recent COVID-19 business support program.
Fantastic. Let me take you back to yesterday. Teenage pregnancy. Africa Education Watch pushes for flexible SHS reentry for girls. This story is by Delali Adogla Besai. Says policy research and advocacy NGO Africa Education Watch has advocated for more flexible admissions into senior high schools for girls who try to return to school after getting pregnant. This comes in the wake of his research indicating that the closure of schools during the coronavirus pandemic increased the rates of teenage pregnancy. Kofi Asari, who is the executive director of the group, told the City Breakfast Show that the current architecture of admissions under the Free SHS program did not permit re-entry.
Well, if you go to page 17 of the Daily Graphic this morning, stop forced early marriages. This is coming from the chief imam. The national chief imam, Sheikh Osman Nuhu Sharabutu, has reiterated the call to end harmful practices such as forced and early marriages, which prevents girls from realizing their potential. According to him, such practices were not only immoral, but also harmful to the development of young girls, particularly girls. He said girls are, for that matter, women had a critical part to play in the development of any nation, and therefore forcing them to marry at tender ages was backward and an affront to the rights of young girls. And just to give you a number, says that over 90% of married girls are out of school compared to 18% of their unmarried peers.
Now, let me do a few fact-checking stories that Star News have done. Now, they've done two. Alabi's claim that MPP promised one child one chocolate in 2016 is mostly false. This story is done in essentially saying that campaign manager for opposition NDC, Joshua Alabi, on Tuesday granted an interview on Star FM in response to Information Minister's reaction to the NDC's manifesto launch. In the interview, the former UPSC vice chancellor said the governing MPP has a bad track record when it comes to fulfilling campaign promises. He went on further to claim that in 2016, the MPP promised one child one chocolate. But they did the verification and found out that this was mostly false. Then they did another one on Mahama. He had said that the NDC managed 2016 budget without BOG borrowing. Again, this was said during the campaign of the manifesto launch. Their fact checker analyzed the claims on three grounds, and they found out that this too was false. Meanwhile, the youth organizer of the NDC is saying Mahama will pay men's gold customers who deserve to be paid. As men's gold customers who did not earn dividends equivalent to their initial investment will receive, all men's gold customers who did not earn dividend equivalent to their initial investment will receive their monies back if the NDC wins the 2020 polls. National youth organizer of the party has said, hey, according to George Opariadu, the NDC will institute a probe into men's gold customers' claims and pay the credible ones. They even quote him. First of all, men's gold customers are Ghanaians and the state must care. The next NDC government will probe the claims and pay those who deserve to be paid. That's the escape clause. There are customers who do. There are customers who did not earn anything on their capital. Such people must be paid. And there are those who earn enough dividends equivalent to their investment, he told Bolare on StarChat.
The Inquisitor. 3 in 10 police officers have suicidal thoughts.
Wow.
A research paper by the Ghana Psychological Association has shown that nearly 3 in 10 police officers in urban Ghana report having had thoughts about taking their own lives during the previous 12 months.
Why?
Also, ongoing research indicates that some displaced staff and survivors of the recent banking sector cleanup have also contemplated and attempted suicide. The Ghana Psychological Association has thus called for the concerted efforts toward the prevention of suicide, as 1 in 10 adults in rural communities think about taking their own lives as well. In the same report, among school-going deaf adolescents, 1 in 10 students report attempting suicide in the past 12 months. In second cycle schools, 2 in 10 students reported intentional self-injury or self-poisoning in their lifetime.
Wow.
5 adolescents who identify as LGBT engage in self-poisoning or self-injurious behaviors.
Research is this?
This revelation was made on Thursday, September 10th, to mark World Suicide Prevention Day on the theme Working Together to Prevent Suicide. According to the Ghana Psychological Association, it's a clarion call for a collective effort towards suicide prevention.
Well, better two stories from the BNFT for you. On page 2, mining communities denied royalties for 2.5 years.
Hey!
The Ghana Extractive Industries Transparency Initiative report has uncovered that disbursement of mineral royalties to communities affected by mining activities left a 2.5 year gap unpaid and unaccounted for. According to Gaiti, data gathered from the Office of Administration of Stolands indicated that the last transfer of mineral royalty receipts to communities impacted by mining was made from payments by mining companies to in the period April to June 2014. Ordinarily, when disbursement was to resume in 2017, it was expected that payment would continue from where it left off. However, it was observed that the first payment in 2017 was made from payments by mining companies between January and April 2017. The report also uncovered a varying applicable slide in investment stabilization agreements for different companies in terms of paying royalty rates. Wow. For instance, in an event of gold price reaching $1,750, Goldfields is to pay royalties at 4%, while Anglo Gold Ashanti would pay 4.5% as others pay 5%. So quite a lot going on in that space, Bernard.
All right.
You also said there was another story. You said there were
The WAEC.
Which WAEC was?
Can only confirm cheating after marking.
Seriously.
The West African Examinations Council, WAEC, has said that it can only determine if candidates who sat for this year's West African Senior Secondary Certificate examinations cheated or not after the papers have been marked and an assessment of the results made. WAEC has described several reports of widespread leakage of examination questions and answers on social media platforms as false, saying the incident rather swayed students from a holistic learning approach. Wow. Wendy E. Adilamte, head of National Office of WAEC, told the BNFT in an interview that there are a lot of ways that exam boards tackle cheating. When you suspect cheating, there are softwares that we use and there are procedures that we undertake.
Let me end with Graphic. Graphic Communications Group urges Parliament to settle its debts. This story is on citynewsroom.com. The Graphic Communication Group Limited has asked Parliament to settle its debt for the supply of newspapers since May 2020. According to the managing director of the company, Atuafo, Parliament and other state institutions are indebted to the company. Now, this was disclosed at Public Accounts Committee hearing yesterday, September the 10th. Mr. Atuafo told the committee that we've been following up, and they, Parliament's Account Committee, said they will make payments to us in due course. I can't mention the amount owed us immediately, but we'll get to you the official figures. Chairman of the committee, James Averji, assured that Parliament will surely clear the debt. Charlie, state agency matter. Anyway, that's all we have time for on the newspaper review. Thank you, Kokui. Thank you, Godfred. There's a lot happening. City Business News is next.